for another opportunity to hear last Sunday's snapshots. Carrie Crowley is talking to Gladys Hickey, who recently returned from England to publish her late mother's book about her family, Turna of Carfort.
Gladys Hickey, I have in my hand a book called Turna of Carfort by a lady called Lily O'Reilly. And this book was, while not quite an autobiography, it was certainly written about the person who wrote it, but in the third person, and completed in 1978. Lily O'Reilly was your mother, and Lily O'Reilly never published the book, but you have published the book almost 25 years on. How come you have finally decided to publish it, or how come you even thought about publishing it?
I hadn't realised it was 25 years. In 1992, when my mother died, I went through the entire house finding bits of paper here and there with poems, songs, boxes of plays, folders of songs, newspapers, press reviews, and I gradually began to collect my mother's pen work. And I would do so much on one visit and come back to Ireland again and find a few more papers. So it must have been about 1993 I found the box under the bed in what was our playroom. And that's where I discovered that the date was 1978.
And was the entire manuscript of Turna in that box, that box that you found under the bed, or was it scattered? I mean, did you find a bit here and a bit there?
It was all together in handwriting. And if my mother hadn't put 1978 at the end, I wouldn't know when it had been written.
But you did know that it was her story, and your story, the story of your family.
It was obvious from the descriptions of South Galway and the names, the four.
The names of the four children?
The names of the four. And the sisters of my mother, and how farm life, the picture given by my mother, was more or less the picture in my mind of the farm where she was born. Parts of it are pure fiction, like that cycling tour, I think. I don't think my mother ever did that. It was just to add interest, I think.
But a lot of it is the story of all your lives, the lives of your family.
Certainly.
Yeah. And how much of it, going back to her own life, because she does speak about Turna as a younger girl, Turna being Lily O'Reilly, your mother, how much of her life had she told you down through the years, or how much new information did you glean from the manuscript about your mother and about her early days?
Extremely little. Because what's there is what we knew, generally speaking. The part of my mother that I knew least about was the creative side. I didn't know when she wrote the poems, and they're there by the hundred. Because we never saw papers left out on a table, on any table in the house. It was all done, not secretly, but very methodically, I think.
Yeah.
We never saw my mother write. And this is why she had the help when we were younger, so that she could go away quietly. But either we children were very uninterested in what my mother was doing, or she was adept at working away secretly.
And do you think her husband, your father, knew and supported the writing?
It would be part of his looking after my mother that whatever Lily would want to do would be right. He was that kind of self-effacing person. And to an extent, they had separate lives. To an extent.
To what extent?
Well, Daddy could get up on his bike and travel up to Dublin if he wanted to, when he liked. And he could go to America and see his brothers just occasionally.
Mm.
And he could go and visit his friend James and have long chats about manly things into the night. And I feel there were two strong individuals who almost unconsciously supported each other.
And yet, it's very apparent in the book that they were totally in love with each other.
Well, I have their early declarations. We know that in the Ireland of that period, many matches were made among men and women. But as far as I know, this was a pure love match. Because their little letters, a few of the letters that they wrote, little cards, are still there, you know, talking of true affection.
And how far apart had they grown up, if they were sending these letters to each other after they met? Or were they writing from different parts of the country?
Oh, in Galway. Because Daddy was in the police work in Peterswell, and Mammy lived just about 6 miles away. He just came over on his bike. But they weren't madly demonstrative people. It's more respect for each other as well they had. And they gave good example always. I never ever heard my mother raise her voice. Not once. And she never beat us when we deserved it. I took a beautiful bedspread once belonging to my mother because I wanted to, the fringe part for dolls' houses. And I threw the bedspread out the window to my little friends. And my mother found out, and she never slapped me. She just had an expression on her face that you knew she was not pleased. But she never laid a finger on any one of us.
And would your father have?
No, my father never laid a finger either.
Mm.
But he was very careful of us. If we wandered, he would come out after us. If we wandered out the road, he'd never let us get into any harm.
It says on the back of the book about your mother that she was born in County Galway at the turn of the 20th century. What kind of life was it in Galway back then?
I must just remember what my mother said, that farming was very, very difficult. I mean, my grandfather was out there with his bare hands cleaning fields. Because there were no government grants or no great financial wizards in the family, things became very, very difficult. There was even talk of selling that farm, which was a big farm by those by the standards of the day. It was 105 acres.
And how many of them were there? How many children were in the family?
Five. But they were all good workers. And my mother, having that joyful nature, describes their work as happy.
Mm.
And it comes across they were singing in the fields as well as eating nice apple pie, I hope, and nice things. And they were singing in the house as well. So they seemed to me to be a happy family. But a thing my mother doesn't mention in the book is that my grandfather had an alcohol problem. And that helped, I suppose, in not being able to cope 100% with the difficulties on the farm.
It contributed to him not being able to...
To the other.
Yeah.
And I don't know the extent of it, because we were told certain things, but there was never any more said on a particular subject. That's the way it was.
Mm. Pick some music, Gladys. We have a number of songs to get to, and you actually have some hymns thrown into the mix as well. You are now living in England and have been for the last long time, but you have a few Irish songs as well, and you specifically wanted A Bhacha Tú Maithí Maisin.
I would like to hear that again because of the beauty of the melody.
Seval she son bar, the brother be her a hushin, her a hushin, her a hushin, the brother be her a hushin, the papin her no cloak. Galar skalta she machine, a story no gma wachelin, a galar skalta she machine, is a laurin bean a foca. Her a grim pamalin, the pamalin. Pauline Bug, come all in bug. Peregrine, come all in bug. As a lone sheen, come a stoha. Rocko, hey, mon ali. Hey, pom, on chretten, ya benim. Rocko, hey, mon ali. Hey, my kele, bon doce. Kram, oh, rima, hey, machine. Mastorin, hog, ma, wachelin. Kram, oh, rima, hey, machine. Her, ma, jin, estranova.
Nakasade and Anwakatu Mahemashin, Gladys Hickey, your first music choice today. Have you kept up your Irish, even though you now reside in England and have done for a long time?
My late husband was a frequent visitor to Galway. He loved it, loved its people. And he often said, you should be reviving your Irish. And I looked at him blankly. It didn't mean a thing. And poor Ray would go, Manaw. Fear, brusker, and that was that. And about 2-3 years ago, the Irish Post gave me the opportunity to revive the Irish because they advertised Irish classes all over London, Hammersmith, Camden, everywhere. And I went eagerly to Hammersmith, where I met a very good teacher, and I started at the beginning again, Tussie Horry.
And how much has come back?
If you do Irish for 5 years at school, only a certain amount is learned.
Mm.
So a good deal of that will come back. But conversation is different now in the 90s and the 2000s. So it is like learning another language in some ways.
That's interesting. So it's like learning another language because of society rather than because of the language?
Both. The present generation, like, they like certain colours, they like certain fashions, well, they like certain phrases in Irish also. And it's no use giving a word that was fashionable in 1940 because the young people will not want to know. Or if you said an idiom, they would say, oh no, we will say it a quicker way. And they want things quick and smart and fun sec. They love things like that.
Yeah.
Where we didn't know anything about fun sec, for instance. But in London, anyone who is in the class is there because he or she wants to learn. And it's a nice environment to be in.
And back at home, growing up in Dunmore in County Galway, was Irish spoken anywhere nearby or was it predominantly English speaking?
Not one solitary word.
Yeah.
In North Galway. In the era that I was brought up in.
So we're talking the 30s.
The 30s, beginning of the 30s and the 40s. Yeah. We were free little children. There wasn't one word of politics. There wasn't one word of war. It didn't get through to us. We were born into a comparative peace. We had little friends in the street and played games in a haunted house. We made up our own games. I'm sure if Frankie or Mary were listening to me now, or Peg, they would know all the games we played. But outside that, we were quite private. We didn't ask questions about what went on in anybody else's house, and they didn't ask us.
And were either of your parents from there, or were they migrants to Dunmore?
Yes, they were transplants. My mother came from Kilcreest. My father came from Cavan. And because he was transferred from the depot in Dublin down to Peter's Well in South Galway, that's how he came to meet my mother.
Hmm.
And when they married, they were transferred to Dunmore, where my mother lived for the rest of her life.
There were four of you in the family, you being the eldest. Gladys, about to be called Dolores by your father, but changed to Gladys. Why was that?
Well, Mammy said there's enough Dolores in the world, we'll have some brightness in here. So she went the opposite of Dolores, and Gladys was the first thing she thought of.
And what, Dolores is connected to tears, isn't it?
It seems to be connected, yeah, with sadness. So Alma was the second name in honour of Our Lady, and Noeline for Christmas.
So, and Gladys then, the eldest. And then who came along?
Victor was next, 3 years later. And Elizabeth called after my mother, and then Justin came in 1945. But by the time I'd been through college, Victor was doing his intercert, and Father Hughes in his college saw very great promise in him and expected his first book by the age of 21. Well, instead of that, Victor went downhill, just seemed to withdraw and dry up, and all the promise vanished. And he became totally withdrawn and ill, and had to be sent to St. Bridget's in Ballinasloe. After 3 months, he got well enough to be sent home, relapsed and remained in St. Bridget's, and his time there was seriously ill because of violence and not knowing his family. He didn't know me when I went there, and before the age of 50 he had to be placed in a ward with all old people. He then developed what is thought was an ulcer, and he was treated in the Portiuncula, and my mother had the joy of seeing him look right for the first time in, was it 20 years. The lovely blue eyes he had, big blue eyes, and exceptionally peachy coloured skin. And for a moment, I think she had the privilege of seeing her son not looking tormented, and he was her favourite child, and he had enough insight as he went out to the hospital to say to her, "Mammy, I'll never be no good for you."
This was the first time, or this was after the ulcer?
Oh, the first
time. The first time.
Yes, the ulcer was at the very end, yeah, of his life. It killed him. That's what he died from, at the age of 52.
Your mother has written about it in the book as Turner. So she describes herself as Turner, she describes Victor as Vane, and she describes Justin as Jay. And I really do want to talk about that and the effect it must have had on all of you, all of the family. But will we go with more music first? If you would, just pick another piece of music and then we'll come back into talking about that.
Eichriest an Chiel.
Why this one, Gladys?
Well, when schizophrenia occurs in the family, there are two sides to the acceptance of it. One must accept where medicine is at any given point, and one realizes that our Lord is the creator. And this is why I chose the seed is Christ's, because the seed of Christ was in those two boys.
Christ unveiled, Christ.
Gladys Hickey, the second piece of music you've chosen to play today for a particular reason, and you link it in with the schizophrenia of both your brothers, because Victor was the first to develop it, and Victor had huge promise. As you say, he was seen by this priest in the school as a likely candidate for authorship, that he would have his first book by the age of 21. And instead your parents, and Lily describes it as Turner and Peter, having to decide or having to allow their son in his teens to have electric shock therapy. Can you remember that happening? Can you remember them having to make that decision or having to deal with that?
Well, I was in England by that time, and there was a knock on my door one January evening. I had just returned from Ireland seeing my parents, and there was my brother Victor. And words were not necessary, because I knew the moment I looked at him, his mind had gone. So he came in, and we tried to give him some food and gave him my bed, and I went down and slept with a nice friend I had in the street, because that was Bolton in those days. It was really like Ireland. And the next day we came back to Ireland. The doctor said home surroundings are essential for this boy. So Victor came over with me.
And how had he made his way to England in the first place?
That is a mystery only known to God and Victor.
Yeah.
He went hop picking in Kent, like all the schoolboys of that era. He hadn't been in touch with my parents, and they thought, as a young independent man, he's too busy leading his own life. He's got new friends. He'll write when he feels like it. Instead, he turned up on my doorway, and I never, at the time, I thought, how in his state could he remember my address? And I've lived with that question my entire life. How did he know? Well, I was delighted he knew, needless to say. So we got into Dublin, and there at the Gresham Hotel, there was a lovely, in those days they had the horse-drawn hansom cab outside, and I thought, Victor and I are going to step into that, and we're going over to Westland Row. And I knew in my heart, I felt it was the last time we would do anything really beautiful together. And I was determined it would be beautiful. And we silently arrived at the station and he sat down. He had a very lithe physique. He was athletic and was a very handsome boy in those days. And he leaned back on the seat and he said, "Untrammeled man." And that summed Victor at that stage. He remained that till the day he died.
And going back to him being hospitalised then, and your parents having to make decisions about his life, like about the electric shock therapy, or about him becoming a resident of a hospital and never actually being able to live a normal life again, was that all discussed at home, or did each of you cope with it individually? Can you remember?
Well, it overwhelmed us. Even though we all went about our normal lives, we were not normal from the moment we saw Victor ill, because treatment consisted of going into the hospital and the good nurses there just trying to keep him fed, clothed, and under a roof. That was the treatment and medication. Now, I've discovered, I was speaking to a friend last year, and she told me, when I was a nurse, there were four types of schizophrenia. This nun friend told me there are 187 varieties of schizophrenia. So the knowledge...
So it's much more finely tuned now.
That has increased knowledge. Because the big mental hospitals were closed down. And the approach and the new training of doctors resulted in different ways of doing things.
Mm. And you became a nurse because of Victor. Am I right in saying that you hadn't, that wasn't what you'd originally trained to do?
No, I was in the civil service. I was clerical, was my field. I went into that hospital to find out what mental illness was and what the prognosis was.
And how long did you stay at that? How long did you stay in the nursing profession?
3 years.
Yeah.
3 years.
And did it help? Did it give you a greater understanding or greater knowledge?
Oh, it gave me a vast understanding of the nature of the illness, what it does to families, how each person is still an individual, even though they're ill. They will still make friends among themselves. They'll make friends among the staff. And in those days in England, we were into group therapy, which came to Ireland later on. And that was, my younger brother was tried in all these treatments, psychology, and they all had to be scrapped because he wasn't interested. No one has got the key yet. There are some patients, I believe, and that we haven't got the key to them yet. I might be naive to think there is a key.
Yeah. And Justin is still alive, so, I mean, is that something that you would love to see happen, for that key to be found for him and his particular branch or brand of schizophrenia?
It would be marvellous.
Yeah. How old is he now?
He is 58 now.
And was there kind of 10 or 12 years between him and Victor in age?
Victor was born in 1937, Justin in 1945.
So eight years kind of, yeah.
Eight.
And was it at a similar time in their lives that the onset became obvious?
Victor developed it around the age of 16, 17. That's when the personality changed.
Yeah.
But poor Justin developed it at puberty. He never developed as a man. He had no life. He was a child, and then he was a schizophrenic. And he was a very happy child. Very happy, carefree child. He wanted to be a soccer reporter. He adored soccer.
And did anybody ever answer your questions that you might have had, or your parents' questions, as to why both of them suffered from the same illness?
Different forms of it, because Justin always knew me. Victor didn't. We don't know. The medical world doesn't know organically why it occurs. But an awful lot of the treatment is psychological.
Mm.
And keeping the patients very comfortable and well fed, and doing the staff do what they can socially for them.
It just seems, compared with what they had ahead of them, you know, particularly Victor, who you describe as something of a prodigy, that never came to fruition.
Victor had a gold medal for oratory. I have it today. And as the priest, I think it's in the book, the priest said in his homily that God gifted him, but then it was his will not to use the gifts. And these are the mysteries of life.
Pick a third piece of music. And your music choices, you obviously have a faith, and your mother obviously had a faith, because she describes herself in the book as Turner, woman of faith. And I would love to come back to that. So do you want to go with, what would you like to go with now? It's your choice. What do you think you'd like to hear?
May I hear Gounod's Ave Maria.
And why this one specifically? Why this Ave Maria?
It will join all the family together.
Gladys Hickey, before the break, we heard Gounod's Ave Maria, and we had already heard it, Crias than Sheila, and I just said to you that your faith, your own faith, seems to come across almost blindingly. It's very, very obvious in you. And your mother described herself as a woman of faith in her book, Turna of Carfort. Was that something that she passed on to you, or is it something, do you think, that has evolved in you over time and over the years?
Well, my mother had such a tender, childish love of God that you couldn't escape from it. There was nothing frightening or mysterious about God.
And when you say childish, do you mean that she had a naive faith, or do you think it's something that she mulled over and questioned and sorted out in her
head? It was a trust that seemed to be born with her, part of her nature, part of her breathing. She couldn't be any other way. And I think that is true, because the tests in the book prove that to me.
What do you mean when you say the tests in the book?
Well, the tests, I can see my mother standing at the crossroads, literally, where she met my father. If she hadn't met my father, where would the crossroads in life have led her? But her crossroads gave her four children, and she loved her children. And it was like as if she never had them, because the two boys were ill. Elizabeth was killed in a road accident, and I was in another country. Only saw her 1 week every year.
From what age? From 18 or 19 on?
Yes.
And what age was Elizabeth when she died?
Elizabeth was just 38, had been round the world, had friends everywhere. She had this great gift of warmly including every single person she met. And Elizabeth met me in London, and we had great times. She was a good sister. And I always, not a day goes by, but I will remember my brother and sister.
And what happened to her? Like, you say she died at 38 in a car crash. Was it in Ireland or was it abroad?
Well, first of all, she taught in County Monaghan in St. Louis. Then she wanted to see what comprehensive education was like. So she went over to Ashford. And when she had enough learned there, she was on Swedish TV discussing education there. And she knew how to speak 8 languages. But she decided to return to Ireland. And she went to Glenstall. And she was only there 5 weeks. And she'd been visiting my mother and father, and she had a sore throat. Sounds simple, doesn't it? And my mother said, begged her not to go back because the roads were icy. And Elizabeth looked ill, but she said, I have to go back. It's a new job. I must be willing. So she set off, went to Mass in Limerick, and at Bunratty, a van and herself, her car, collided and spun in the ice, and she lived for 2 days in Barrington's hospital. And the doctors consoled my parents by saying, they tried to console my parents by saying, had she lived, she would have been a vegetable. But they were totally stricken, and people in the town who knew them well just said they aged overnight. But they never complained or moaned about things. They were sad in their hearts, but they got on with life.
You mentioned Elizabeth because you were talking about the tests in the book. Like, do you see that as being a test to your mother's faith as well? Do you think that if she kept a faith after going through that and after going through Victor and Justin, that that was an absolute sign of her faith? Is that what you're...
Not absolute, because I believe a faith like that comes, I would say it came from her mother, and maybe further back than that. It's in you, it's in you.
Well, let's look at your own faith, or your own belief, or even just your own faith in life and justice and balance and stuff. How did you feel after Elizabeth was killed in the car crash? And you'd already witnessed both Victor and Justin being so ill that they were hospitalized. Like, what did you see as the lot of your family? Or did you at any stage rail against what could be seen as injustice?
It's a very complex question. Because a Christian is taught that Christ suffered, so it's a privilege to suffer. And that thought does sustain you. Because you feel support. You feel there is something supporting you through it all. And prayer is faith, because you're praying to the unseen.
And when you pray, when Gladys Hickey prays, do you pray known prayers that you recite from memory, or is it a language that you have that is entirely different to any other language that you have? Is it something that's just between you and the God that you know?
Well, I'm at the stage now where I try now, I haven't succeeded, but I'm beginning to want to listen. Because that is my development at the moment. That is the stage where I'm at.
And do you mean listening to other people? Or do you mean listening for inspiration?
I mean listening as an older person now and wondering where to live, for instance. Will I live in England? Will I live in Ireland? I think having no husband to guide me, no brothers, no sisters, no. I must be quiet. And in the quiet, something will happen that I don't expect. I'm sure that could be a possibility.
Okay. Fourth music choice. This is your silent amour.
Yes, because my brothers were silent from the world, the nice things of the world. They didn't hear the rivers run, or the birds sing, or the airplanes go over, or the cars go down to the nightclub. So this is why I chose silent amour.
Suzanne Murphy and Silent O'Moyle, Gladys Hickey, your fourth music choice for your brothers, Victor and Justin. You said, when we were talking there about faith, and you said that you have nobody to guide you, you have no husband to guide you, no brothers to guide you, no sister to guide you. You were married to an Englishman, Ray, for a long number of years, a man you describe as a gentleman.
Yeah, gentleman, as anyone in Dunmore will tell you. Smile in his eyes. He loved the people he met. He didn't say too much. He just met his fellow men along the road. And Ray was always there, always.
And how had you and he met?
Well, we met unexpectedly. It was in Richmond Park. My friend and myself were waiting for
Margot's friend. He'd gone up to play tennis at the club. And we sat there waiting. And when Margot's friend turned up, Ray was with him. So we were talking. And I remember thinking, what nice manners he has. And that was that. And then I had a phone call, would I go to The Sound of Music? And of course, 3 weeks had gone by and I thought, oh, well, there's nothing much there. Probably someone else let him down or something. He's asking me to go. But from that night on, we were never separated. There was something that drew me to Ray.
And what year was that?
1962.
And you were together until 95. Was it 95 that he died?
Yes.
And in Turn of Carfort, your mum's book, there's a character, you are Gay in it, and Gay is married to a man called George, and George is a great singer. Was Ray a great singer, or did she add that to his character?
Ray was a pleasant singer, no. Actually, his mother was a very nice singer, his mother, Madge. He had a pleasant voice, there's no doubt about that. But his real choice of music would be, uplifting stuff. Like Elgar, and had to be uplifting, raising the rafters with Glory to God, and really
huge classical pieces.
They had to be big sounding.
Yeah. And were you back in the civil service at that stage? Once you did your 3 years nursing, what did you then do?
Oh, I went back to the clerical field again.
Yeah. And what did Ray do?
Ray was an optician by trade. He thought he was going to be a doctor at first, and did a year, having done a year in an acting school, mind you. He thought he was going to be an actor. But the doctoring was in the family, so he did a year, and then the RAF stepped in. So he found himself out in Burma and these places. I have all the little tin mugs and souvenirs, and little satchels and things. I have them in the garden shed, like as ornaments now. And he loved it again, his letters to his parents, sometimes 18 pages. He wrote everything in detail. They were beautiful letters as he went down. You could see it all happening. He'd go down the street and into the cinema with his friends. You could see it all happening before your eyes, because he was very close to his mother. He was the only boy.
Did you have children yourselves?
No.
Have you any family?
Among us four children, there is no little grandchild for my parents. And Ray had a sister, but she hasn't any children. And our cousin Keith has no children. And cousin Madge.
Interesting, though, wasn't it, that out of the family, that it'd be like that across your family and his family?
That's the way it is.
Yeah. What are you going to do now? As you say, you now have no husband to guide you, and you do have that decision to make. Ray died in 95, with a smile on his face.
Indeed.
You say?
Indeed. How could I forget it? He, lying there, as if to say, don't worry about a thing. It's lovely here. That's what his face said. But, of course, his sister said to me, oh, Ray was an actor. She's so realistic.
So he was hemming it up at the end. So
she's realistic, and that was her view.
Yeah. But what are you going to do? What's Gladys going to do now? You've brought out your mum's book, Turn of Carfort. I presume you want to try and spread her story and maybe have her other work recognised, her poems.
I read the book, and I left it aside. And I read it later. I typed it later on. And I left it in the cupboard, and I read it again, and I was touched by it. But I always knew my mother was special, but now I thought she's more special than I thought. And whatever happens to the book, because the readers have the free choice, whatever happens, I really feel that had I stayed in Ireland, I would have helped my mother in some way with her work, because she couldn't do all the clerical work involved with it. And here I am, just the first step now along the way. And whether the book is a success or not, I will continue to type the poems, send them to publishers, and I'm hoping to have everything she wrote in a book. And I'd be happy then.
Your final music choice. This is Elgar. This is for Ray.
Well, this is for Ray because he brought such happiness to me, first of all, and to honour him and to join him up with our family, where my mother and father always welcomed him as a son.
Go in the name of angels from Elgar's Dream of Gerontius. Gladys Hickey's final music choice, ending Snapshots, which was first broadcast last Sunday. Snapshots is produced by Liz Sweeney. Next week, Carrie's guest is journalist and author Eugene McIldowney.